Good afternoon, everybody. My name's Steve Davis. I'm a curator here at the Wittliff Collections. I'm very happy to welcome you all to our celebration of Marc Simmons. My original plan was to make only a few very brief remarks so we could get on with our program, but I started getting these letters from Marc in the mail with very precise and detailed instructions on things I need to say to you all. So I will go on for just a couple of minutes, so please forgive me for that. Marc would have loved to be here today, you know. He's not really up to making the long trip from his home outside of Santa Fe. He's nearly 80 years old. He still suffers the lingering effects of a near-fatal automobile accident in 1986. And after that head-on collision, the doctors were so certain that he was going to die that they informed newspaper reporters who began writing obituaries for Marc. Of course, what the doctors and reporters didn't know was how stubborn and hard-headed Marc is. He was in the middle of his book on Juan de Oñate, and he sure as hell wasn't going to give that up. So he pulled through, finished the book, and has been keeping busy ever since. And when you look at the exhibit, if you haven't seen it already, you'll see one of the newspaper stories about that accident that Marc had. You just have to look for the headline that reads, "State historian declares he is alive and working." Marc is, of course, more than just New Mexico's most beloved historian. He's one of the great historians of our age, the author of nearly 50 books, recipient of many honors, the high esteem of his colleagues. He's also published a weekly newspaper column on history that's appeared for almost 40 years, some 2,000 columns in all. And when you read Marc's books and his columns, you'll see that he's not just a great historian, he's also a first-class writer. And in that regard, he is the perfect fit for this collection here. Marc spent 60 years now building a vitally important research collection on the Southwest. Over the years, he's freely shared his library and archives with fellow writers and other historians. And now, thanks to the help from many supporters and from Marc's own generosity, we can share that collection with the rest of the world. The private library that Marc built contains about 12,000 volumes, many of them very rare and valuable books. And when we purchased that library from Marc about 2 years ago, it immediately nearly doubled the size of our existing book collection here. And beyond those books that we purchased, Marc has donated about 300 boxes of archives to us. These are the big banker's boxes. These are full of incredible research materials, historic documents, artifacts, photographs. Because the thing about Marc's collecting is, you know, he only finished about 50 books himself, but he collected enough material for another 100. Mm-hmm. And now he's passing that treasure trove on to future generations. And that's part of what we're celebrating today. And so we do have these voluminous files available to researchers on a wide variety of Southwestern topics, everything from diverse American Indian lifeways to the complexities of the Spanish colonial era, essential research on Kit Carson, Santa Fe Trail, 20th century writers and artists and photographers. And the list just goes on and on. One of the reasons Marc's archive covers such a wide range is that that's the way his own mind works. And I think one of the remarkable things about him as a historian is that he will frequently take on subjects that seem essential to us, many of us as lay people, but other historians really haven't thought to ask. Like, for example, how did people go to the bathroom back in the old days? And, you know, the answer is somewhat complicated, but I promise you, if you go visit Marc, who lives straight out of the 19th century, you'll pick up a few clues. And he does, he has a gift for describing everyday life in the past in ways that kind of take the blinders off for us and open up those past worlds in a real immediate way and make us feel really connected to the people of those times. And I think one of the examples that struck me was reading his descriptions of the dogs in the past. And you know, if you think about those Indian Pueblo villages that we're all familiar with, you know, the mud-colored, multi-story adobe dwellings with the ladders and so forth, Did you know that the Indians' dogs could actually just clamber up and down those ladders without any problem at all, dart into doorways? And, you know, that really just blew the minds of the Spaniards when they showed up. They couldn't believe these dogs could do that. And, you know, here's something that freaked out the Anglos when they came to the Southwest. Those roadside crosses, which when the Anglos came, they thought those all marked graves, actual grave sites. And they wondered why people couldn't be bothered to haul dead persons off to the Campo Santo for burial. And Mark notes that this practice of the roadside crosses, which we're of course familiar with here from highway deaths, dates back to medieval Spain. And so I'm curious if anyone in the audience knows what those crosses back in the Spanish colonial era in New Mexico represented at the time that were on the side of the road. Does anybody know?
Some of them were deaths from bandits and brigands.
Yeah. Exactly, and that's what Mark has pointed out. A lot of them were places where ambushes took place and people were killed. And Mark says that in some places on the road, there were a lot of these crosses. So if you can just imagine, you know, let's say you're going to Taos and you have to pass through this mountain pass and you see this forest of crosses at this convergence, what are you gonna do at that point? I asked my wife that last night. She said, I'm gonna turn around. And that's what a lot of people did. So many so that it really affected, you know, commerce and travel. And so Mark points out that the Spanish governor of Santa Fe resolved the problem. He ordered those crosses removed. I just want to mention one more kind of cool thing. And again, this is a guy who wrote 50 books, 2,000 newspaper columns. I had the most fun going through his archive preparing this exhibit. So I just want to mention one more little Mark story from his work. This is something else that freaked out the Anglos who came to the Southwest, and maybe still does in some ways. That's the very heavy makeup that women wore here. The universal cosmetic, as Mark describes it, was a reddish-tinted, very thick flour paste that women put on from their chin to their forehead. And the Anglos could not understand why they did that. But as Mark would point out, you know, there's a reason for that place and that time why women here wore such thick paste, really, a plaster almost. Any ideas? Why in this place women would wear sunscreen, exactly. And why at that time? That's the other part of the question. At this time, it was advantageous to keep your face thickly covered because of the smallpox scars that many people had. So, yeah. And he does. Like I said, he just kind of opens up your eyes to how people live and connects us to the present. It's quite a gift he has as a historian. Okay, well, before we begin our program, I want to recognize some of the very generous people who helped make our purchase of Mark's library possible. I also want to recognize some of the distinguished guests we have here from the university. We're very fortunate and pleased to have our Vice President, Mr. Ken Pierce, here today. We have our Associate Vice President for the University Library, Joan Heath, is here. Hi, Joan. And we have a great compadre of Mark's, the founding donor for the Wittliff Collections, Mr. Bill Wittliff, is here. Bill, great to see you. Some of the donors who helped us raise money for the Simmons Library include Ellen Ray and the Stillwater Foundation, Sam and Rebecca Feaster, James Morgan, a retired school teacher named Teresa Chambers. And something else I want to say about the fundraising that we did for that library, and I'm going to mention this because I think it will give you some idea of the high regard and the immense respect our staff here at the Wittliff Collections has for Mark. When we announced the campaign to raise money, 9 of our 11 staff members at the Wittliff contributed substantially. Many of us pledged payroll deductions that took place, were spread out over years, and so all together, you know, you might consider us much of mid-level state bureaucrats, but we raised nearly $10,000 to help support that library. So I want to thank you all, staff, you guys are amazing for what you did. And you know, we've had Mark's library and archive for almost 20 months now. And so I'm going to give you just a quick update on what we've been doing with it. Our hardworking archive staff has now done the preservation and inventory work for all of those nearly 300 boxes I was telling you about. That detailed archival inventory is now posted on our website. If you print it out, it's nearly 200 pages long. So it's quite a resource. on the cataloging of those 12,000 books. We have a great team here at the Alkek Library. We have a serials cataloger, Lynn Smil, who I believe is here today, who's been hard at work. We have Karen Sigler, the head of the Wittliff Collections cataloging department, who's also been helping. And because of that earlier fundraising I mentioned, we were able to hire a special projects cataloger. Her name is Amanda Scott, and I think Amanda's here today as well. Oh, hey, Amanda. And I think all of us who get to work with Mark's materials just, you know, fall in love with him and his work. And Amanda's been doing heroic work to go through these books, many of which require special care and treatment. I checked earlier this week on our catalog, and it shows we have almost 4,000 of those 12,000 titles cataloged. Amanda's one-year appointment runs out in about 5 months.
Four
months. So if any of you want to step forward and fund another year of cataloging, just come talk to me after the program, and we'll see what we can do to make that work. The last thing that I want to mention in regard to Mark's collection is this wonderful idea our director, Dr. David Coleman, who's here today, had. And that is this initiative to encourage research in Mark's papers among students and traveling scholars. We want that archive to inspire those new books, the theses and dissertations, research papers, term papers, published articles. And so we are now raising funds to create a Marc Simmons research grant. We've already gotten our first donation, and it's from that retired school teacher I told you about, Teresa Chambers. We do have pledge cards on your seats, so take a look at those and think about making a pledge to us. And we'd love to have you join us in our work to help Mark's legacy live on. So thank you for that. And my infomercial is now officially over. Thank you for your patience and staying with me. And we can let the fun begin. You may have noticed we're very fortunate to have several members of Mark's family here today. Thank you all for making the trip. It's great to have you here. And I'm going to welcome Mark's niece, Miss Judy Burnett. Judy.
Hello, can you hear me? Is that good?
Yeah.
As he said, my name is Judy Burnett, and Marc Simmons is my mother's brother. My mother, Peggy Ladenberger, right here on the front row, was 11 when Marc was born. And the love affair between the two of them was born that day as well. I don't think there has ever been a sibling pair that has adored each other more than my mother and Marc. When my mother was a teenager, and my mother was 11 when Marc was born, he's been her little brother and still is. But when she was a teenager and she would go on dates with boyfriends, she wouldn't go unless they would agree to let her bring her little brother with them. And when my mother and dad moved to Dallas after the war, the family knew what day that they were arriving, but they didn't know anything more than that, since communication was not what it is today. And all they knew was the day they were arriving, and Marc sat out on the curb in front of their house all day long, waiting to be the one who got the first glimpse of them driving up the street. And he loves to tell that story. My mother is not the only member of our family who adores Marc. Everyone adores Marc. And some of my fondest memories have been the times that we have gathered at his house, and we would pull all the benches and chairs off of the porch of his house and pull them out into the yard and sit in a big circle. And he would regale us with his stories, and it would be either underneath a bright blue sky or a pitch black sky that's just filled with millions and millions of stars. And we would all hang on every word that he would say as he would tell his stories. And he is probably the greatest Southwest historian, but I think he's also probably the greatest storyteller that ever lived. And except for when we would insist on a break where we could all run to the outhouse, he would tell us these stories. And my favorite was always the one of the prison break from the federal prison right down the road, and all of the having to get past the state troopers on his road to get to his house to save his friend Susie and her children, because they were up there in the Badlands where he was just sure that all the prison escapees were going to go. But it is just, the stories were always filled with laughter. And to hear Mark laugh is one of the greatest pleasures in life. Those of you who know him personally, I know you all agree with me that when Mark laughs, it is just so from deep down within, and we all just laugh right along with him. And it's not just my generation that would sit in that circle outside the front of his house. My sisters and I would be there with some regularity, my sister Susan and my sister Jan, and also our children and their children. We have all spent time sitting in Mark's front yard hearing about all these stories. Some of the next generations that are here today, Susan's daughter Carla and her husband Bill are here, and children David and Jeffrey and Katie are also here, and you'll hear from David in just a few minutes. He's going to read an excerpt from one of Mark's books for you. So I'm just so happy that all of you are here, and I'm just happy for all of you that know Mark personally to know what an amazing person he is, besides just what he has produced and given to us in the way of preserving history and life. So thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Judy. And as she mentioned, our next speaker is going to be David Dickinson, a great grandnephew of Mark's, a sophomore at UT Austin. And Mark actually selected David to do this brief reading from his work. This selection comes from Mark's personal epilogue to his landmark History of New Mexico, published to commemorate America's bicentennial in 1976. And Mark, you know, is a narrative historian, so he tells stories. He ended the book with this personal epilogue describing a horseback trip that he took from his home south of Santa Fe out into remote western New Mexico. He had a horse and a pack horse. They enjoyed the hospitality of the Indians at Cochiti Pueblo. And if you've seen the exhibit, you might see that photograph of Mark when he was about 15 or 16 at the Cochiti Pueblo with his brother Hal. He spent many happy summers growing up there. After Cochiti, he rode on to the Jemez Pueblo and then beyond, and that's where David is going to take over the story. Welcome, David.
Hello, everybody. Beyond Jemez Pueblo stretch 20 or so hard miles to the Rio Puerco. At one point, the route cuts across the concrete highway that angles up from Albuquerque, heading to Farmington and the Four Corners. But past that, the 20th century is left behind. When the dry Puerco Valley unfolds beneath you, it is suddenly a world where distance and history count for much, and time and the march of progress count for very little. The Puerco is properly a river when it rises in the San Pedro Mountains farther north. But by the time it reaches the middle valley here, the waters have seeped into the sand, leaving only a damp and deeply entrenched stream bed. The old floodplain, where Spaniards used to farm, extends on either side up to the foot of the sharp-edged mesas capped with basalt. Looking down from those heights, you can easily pick out the dim traces of fields and irrigation ditches. Who could believe now, seeing the 1700s, acres of wheat, corn, and other grains green this valley floor? Sheep and cattle in abundance once grazed beneath the fields, and in the years of drought, they stripped away the ground, covered down to the roots. When the rains came, then nothing held the soil, and the water ran in furious torrents through hundreds of little channels that sliced their way into the Puerco. Overgrazing and arroyo cutting ruined the Puerco Valley. Here, one of the tragic sides of history, man's abuse and neglect of the land, is preserved in an open-air museum for anyone who cares to study it. It's an old story often repeated throughout the Southwest. I steered my horses down the winding valley and through decaying towns whose only adornment land in the sonorous names they still wore. San Luis, Cabezon, Guadalupe, Casa Salazar. One main street after another presented the stereotype picture of a Western ghost town complete with sagging doors and creaky hinges and the banks of tumbleweeds blown against the rotting walls. Long ago, a good road had carried ox carts, then stagecoaches, and finally even a few of Mr. Ford's Model Ts. But the arroyos took that too. The few ranchers who still enter to tend property give their ancestors to Spain, have four-wheel drive rigs. They make their own roads, twisting back and forth to avoid the cuts, and after every rain, picking out a new way. I camped on a high spot with a view and staked out the horses. Alone in such a place, at dusk, the imagination, unbidden, tries to call up departed spirits of Spanish farmers and merchantmen, Navajo and Apache riders, cowboys and cavalrymen. Each shifting shadow or shrill bark of a coyote raises a new apparition, and the determined act of will is needed to prevent a bad case of the dismals from developing. Good medicine is a friendly campfire of juniper sticks, accompanied by a bubbling coffee pot. That combination has served New Mexican travelers well for hundreds of years, and as a source of cheer, it has been nonwise diminished by the onslaught of the modern age. Early in the morning, I prepared to cross the Rio Puerco. The channel's quicksandy bed is notorious, but stories of humans, livestock, and even pickup trucks disappearing into its devouring depths are probably exaggerated. Nevertheless, I took precautions at a likely looking ford. Uncoiling my catch line and tying it fast to the saddle horn, I had me a solid rope to hang on to. As an added safety, I gathered up an armload of stones, and when the horses trailed a few feet behind, walked slowly across the soft bed. Casting the stones ahead and avoiding the places where they went under with a gentle sucking sound, I got my little caravan to the other side without much mishap. Mountain men used the same trick long ago when they moved to the Southwest hunting beaver long ago. I wondered if anyone but myself had recently benefited from it. Leaving the Puerco, I ascended one of its western tributaries, the Rio Salado, a salty little stream that would be called a river only in New Mexico. On one of its little bluffs, I came upon a small ranch that looked deserted. It sat alone and forlorn, a low rock ranch that looked deserted, and it was a mud building with a scatter of pole corrals behind. No truck or jeep was in sight, though a few head of horses grazed in a small fenced pasture. There I saw smoke coming from a stovepipe. Riding in, I took the two Espanol cowboys by surprise. They hadn't seen another soul for weeks. One was old, the other young and brash, and they were starved for talk. I was starved for the beans and the new-made tortillas they offered, so over a plank table in the house, we made a fair swap. A jar of jam from my pack pitch hit for dessert, disappearing faster than cake at a birthday party. The patron, they said, came once a month to Bernadillo to get a report on his cattle and to bring in grub and kerosene. He also hauled drums of drinking water, for that thin trickle in the Salado was too salty for humans, though the stock managed to get by on it somehow. The nearest fresh spring lay miles away, too far for pack water conveniently on horseback. The men had a tough bit of work cut out for them the next day. 50 cows had been grazing on the Mesa de Chivato for the summer, and they planned to make a gather and drive them down to the handy pasture near the ranch. Later in the month, the patron would arrive and help move these and other cattle in the early stages of the upper Puerco, where trucks would be waiting to haul them to the market. They could use the help on the mesa and even tempted me with descriptions of wild country. I could even take one of those little horses out of their remuda if I didn't mind a little bucking first thing in the morning. The old man, small, energetic, with dark-socketed eyes and a set of thin gray whiskers, possessed an untapped well of lore considering the Puerco Basin and the surrounding company. He had listened to stories, legends, and songs of this pocket-sized world and had known men who saw it in better days. With only occasional prodding from me, he talked into the night while I scribbled notes by the oil lamp. Later, before turning into our bunks, the pair asked me to read from an Old Testament. Both men were illiterate. The copy was coverless, tattered, and in Spanish. I read half a dozen of my favorite psalms. They thanked me and bid buenas noches. The trail to the summit of the Mesa de Chivato was the worst I'd ever encountered. My two companions lived by the old cowboy rule, never walk when you can ride. But the last stretch before the top was even too rough for the horses. We dismounted and climbed hand over hand, leaving the horses with loose reins to find their own way. I glanced back and saw them clamoring like goats, their shod hoofs ringing in the brittle rock. The vista at the end made the effort worth it. 100 square miles of broken and seamed country, riven by the Rio Puerto, sprawled beneath us. The cowboys, breathing hard, stared with me, though they had seen it all from this point many times before. Here, elsewhere in New Mexico, the scene is always forever changing, always volunteering, new patterns of light that put out old familiar features of geography in different dress. For the first time, I got a clear view of the basin's most spectacular landmarks, the collection of volcanic plugs or necks, each one a column of congealed lava, rising mountain-like in splendid isolation of the valley floor. These geologic ghosts of extinct volcanoes are fitting monuments in the graveyard of the Puerco. In the northeast, Cabezon Park holds a Navajo crest, shine on its crest. Indians say that the peak was formed after the legendary war twins killed a giant. When they cut off his monstrous head, it turned to black stone. The cattle we wanted were scattered over several miles of Mesa Top. The elevation caught summer rains blown off Mount Taylor to the west and supported a healthy stand of pines interspersed with open grassy meadows. The spring calves had grown fat and sassy. As we made a gather and began working towards the south, they kept breaking from the bunch to frolic and throw their tails in the air. On the lower end of the mesa, we came to an early trail leading to the bottom. The cattle seemed to know where they were leading, good grass, and they balked. We whooped and hollered at them, pelted rumps with our ropes, and rode back and forth like demons trying to shove the leaders over the edge. All we managed to do was dissolve our neat herd into dispersed knots of threes and fours. It was gut-busting, sweating, exhausting work, but this is the way it had always been in the cattle ranges on the west. The old man finally called a halt to let us know there was a better way to do the job than wearing out good horse flesh. We got together a parcel of 10 head or so that we could handle, forced them onto the trail, and moved them about halfway down the mesa to a little pocket that formed a natural holding place. While the old man kept in check there, the youngster and I rode back in to the rim. In less than an hour, we had the remaining cows grouped again. When they picked up the brawling of their herd mates down below, they took to the trail so fast that we had to push to keep up. We bottomed out in a little canyon that descended towards the ranch, so that even though dusk was closing in, it was a simple matter to reach the new pasture. After closing the gate on the cows, we still had a 2-mile ride back to headquarters. I couldn't see my saddle horn in the darkness and worried, knowing the tricky path followed ahead followed close to the edge of the steep Guadarroyos. No te preocupes, do not worry, the cowboy said. These horses can see, even if we can't. They'll take us home. And they did. I still wonder how. A few days later, I caught up with my own horses, preparing to leave the Rio Soldado Ranch. The younger fellow helped me throw a diamond hitch on my pack. If you'll change your mind and stay, he said earnestly, we'll put in a good word with the patron. I think he'll hire you. I smiled at his eagerness and told him again that I was just riding through, getting a feel for the enchanted country. Tierra Encantada. He looked a little puzzled, but let it go at that. As I rode out, a jet streaked and roared across an otherwise flawless October sky, a reminder that the world of the machine had already displaced an older time when muscle and spirit weighed most in the human equation. But quickly, the jet and its feathery trail of vapor were gone, and I was alone again, jogging eastward towards the distant Rio Grande and the blue-black shadow of the Sandia Mountain. Thank you.
That was terrific, David. Thanks so much. And let me ask, what do you guys think of this painting of Marc?
Gorgeous.
Yeah, that's actually on his land. Overlooking the, is that the, which mountains are those? Is that the?
Ortiz
Mountains, that's right. And our next speaker is the artist who created this painting. His name is RON KIL. He grew up as a working cowboy, is now a celebrated artist of the historical West. In 2012, when New Mexico celebrated the centennial of its statehood, RON KIL was announced as the state's official artist that year. His work has won several prestigious prizes, is held in many collections, now including the Wittliff, because RON painted this for us. And RON's been one of Marc's closest friends for many years, much admired for his ability to chop wood and dig trenches and bury old newspapers.
Don't forget the outhouse.
And the outhouse, of course. Ron and his wife Tanya have brought several books here today because Ron's illustrated, I think, at least 40 books now, and many of Mark's books he's illustrated. They brought a collection of the children's books they collaborated on together. Ron got Mark to sign those, and so they're available for sale after the program. And Ron, I think also, did you bring some of your prints as well? No? Okay, yeah, great. So after the program, if you get a chance, stop by and see what they have. I know it's a long drive for you guys from Santa Fe, so thanks so much for coming, Ron Kil.
Folks, it is not possible in the 13 3/4 minutes that Steve has given me to speak. Is that right, Steve? Right. For me to say everything I could about Marc Simmons, but I'll try to hit some high points as we all gather here today to honor both the man and his work. I'd like to start with two quotes. Quote, "Remember the days of old. Consider the generations long past," unquote. Deuteronomy 32:7. Quote, "I have spoken of men who by their art have enriched the features of their land, adding to them pictures, memories, incidents, and interpretations, making them delightful and ennobling for all mankind," unquote. J. Frank Dobie. I believe both these quotes speak true to the life mission of Marc Simmons. I've known Marc for 19 years, illustrated 13 of his books and a score of his magazine and newspaper articles. We've partnered together on many a lecture and presentation. One of our best collaborations has been a set of books called the Children of the West series. Now, this series was born out of Marc's observation that modern-day children's literature is characterized by dark images and a message of gloom and despair. Marc's often spoken to me about his love of the heroic tradition. It's something we both strive to keep alive in our respective work. It's this love of the heroic tradition that was the impetus for the Children of the West series. J. Evetts Haley once wrote, "It is my belief that the stories of men of daring do are an essential part of any strong culture, that they are a spiritual stimulus as well as a stabilizing force for any great and civilized people. And I also believe that they have a place in the minds of healthy children," unquote. Marc and I couldn't agree with that more. The Children of the West series was Marc's way of fighting back against the revisionists' practice of destroying American heroes and traditions. With that, I believe that Marc Simmons' writing is akin to the classical Greek and Roman tradition of heroic literature. One time I was staying with Marc out at his camp. We were sitting on his porch, and we talked from near sundown till long past moonset about the word honor. That's a simple, archaic word that seems to be increasingly out of fashion in this modern day and age. We spent most of the night exchanging anecdotes on frontier characters and how the word honor influenced their actions. Mark's favorite story involves one of his favorite characters and a personal hero of mine, Kit Carson. Kit and fellow trapper Mariano Medina were caught out on the open plains by a Ute war party. Utes numbered about 100 warriors. They spotted them from a distance. Mariano said to Kit, "Make a run for it." You see, Kit was mounted on a large, fast American horse, more than likely a thoroughbred. But Mariano was mounted on a mule. A mule would be no match for those fleet Ute war ponies. Mariano allowed as how he'd hang back and give a good accounting of himself. But again, he urged Kit to escape. Kit later wrote that just for a split second, he considered it, as any human man would do in that situation, though few would be as honest as Kit to later admit it. But seeing the courage of his friend, determined to stay behind and face certain death, Kid vowed to stay and die with him. Now, what I want to do here is I want to paint y'all a word picture. Before I ever touch pencil or brush to canvas and paper, the picture gets painted up here, which is why the mind of an artist can be a wonderful or disturbing thing, depending on his work. The two men stepped down from their mounts. Holding them by the left hands, they hefted their heavy mountain rifles with their right and placed themselves back to back. In no time at all, the Utes were down on them, circling, circling, whooping, hollering, screaming their war cries. The Plains Indians had this habit of painting themselves till they looked like demons that had ridden straight out of hell. Excuse the language. Part of it was religious, and part of it was just to scare the out of their enemies, and it usually worked. So all 100 of these youths were painted up, equipped for war. Few of them might have had mountain rifles. Most of them would have had lances, which were poised for the thrust, and bows strung and drawn back to the arrowhead, waiting for that opportunity to shoot. Now, New Mexico, this takes place in northeastern New Mexico, by the way. Now, New Mexico has been in a perpetual drought for the past 600 years. So you can imagine the amount of dust that 100 ponies times four hooves churned up. I imagine that they could see the dust cloud all the way back in Oklahoma if they were looking. The Utes circled, yelling, screaming, waiting for that final thrust. Kit and Mariano holding on to their plunging mounts. Remember, Kit was riding a thoroughbred. Thoroughbreds are known to do one thing good, run. They are not known for keeping their wits about him in stressful situations. So you can imagine Kit holding on to that one horse with his left hand as it rears, plunges, bucks, kicks, and he's still trying to keep a 13-pound mountain rifle hefted up with his right arm. Now Mariano's mule, knowing mules, was doing one of two things. It was either standing stock still, refusing to move or do anything, or he was probably lashing out with them hind legs trying to connect with a few of those Utes himself. In any event, it was not a good tactical situation. The Utes kept circling. I'm sure it seemed like a carousel of death for an extremely long time to those two men. But finally, seeing that they could not break down their resolve, the Utes withdrew and rode off. The courage and the honor of two men won the day. The annals of the history of the American West are full of such stories. They're the kind of things that Mark and I both draw on for our work. They're, if you will, the grist for our own artistic mills. One of the measures of a man's success is the impact that he has on people around him. Now, Mark has influenced and inspired many people, but the most important of these is our mutual friend, Mark Lee Gardner. Mark Lee, whose most recent book, Rough Riders, is an Amazon bestseller, is one of the West's finest writers, historians, and a researcher without peer. Mark Lee unhesitatingly calls Marc Simmons his mentor. Mark has also said that he considers Marc Simmons to be New Mexico's most important historian, living or dead. That's hard to improve on. You know, one of the things I like best about Mark is that once you get past all this eminent scholar and living legend business, he's just a regular fellow. Unlike most PhDs, he actually knows how to use a post hole digger. He can shoe a horse. He can pack a mule. He made the adobes he used to make his adobe house. Now, he may be a scholar, but those of us with manure on our boots enjoy his books and don't hold that against him. Anybody that knows Mark knows that he has chosen to bypass the 21st century and most of its alleged technological wonders. To Mark, a book is something you find between two covers, to be read, to be collected, and to be treasured. That seems to be a concept that the world is moving away from. I think this quote by J. Evetts Haley, written in 1963, mind you, is a fitting way to end this reminiscence of my friend. Quote, "It is my conviction that even the most fantastic technology, 1963, cannot displace the need, mar the effectiveness, or dim the prestige of the printed word. The airwaves are for the ephemeral moment. The printed word is designed to endure. Folks, what I'd like to do now is to bring up a good friend of both Mark and myself. He's come all the way to us from Bent's old fort on the Arkansas River in southeastern Colorado, Cheyenne and Arapaho country, where he works as a park ranger and historical interpreter. He shall read a short passage from Mark's book, Kit Carson and His Three Wives, which is entirely appropriate. For Mark is known as one of Kit's best biographers. And the man is John Carson, Kit's great-grandson. John.
Even before his death, at the relatively young age of 59, Christopher Kit Carson had attained the image of a national hero and was well on his way to becoming a symbolic figure, personifying the 19th century's ideal of a self-confident man of action. A newspaperman writing up a profile of Kit claimed that he is universally beloved and a favorite of all classes, Indians included. An official of the Kansas Pacific Railroad in the 1870s wrote, "Everyone in this section of the country has a reverence for the memory of Kit Carson. He did more for the civilization of the plains than all other forces, including the Army." And Mark, on behalf of all the Klan, you've done more than anybody since to bring out the truth about Kit and every topic you've ever touched. Thank you. I hope you realize what that really means.
Thank you.
Yeah, and you know, that's one of the things you get out of Mark's work and his archive is really how unfairly Kit Carson's been depicted over the last couple of generations. You know, at the time he was alive, he was considered one of the greatest defenders of the Indians, one of the greatest advocates in the country. And so Mark's kind of been setting the record straight in his work. And for anybody who wants to come do research, you know, we have now, Mark built the largest Kit Carson collection in private hands, and now that's here. And so we've already gotten actually our first inquiry from a scholar in California who wants to come take a look at that material. So, you know, there's just so many treasures there. We're just so privileged to have those here. And so thank you, John and Ron, both. Our next speaker is Phyllis S. Morgan. She's an accomplished biographer and bibliographer. She's the author of award-winning biobibliographies on major Southwestern authors, including Rudolfo Anaya, N. Scott Momaday, Marc Simmons. Her book on Mark. I'm gonna borrow this, Phyllis. You can see it here. The illustrator, Ronald Kill. And our university bookstore has that book for sale here today, so if you're interested in picking up a copy, it's a terrific book. Phyllis, you and Ron will both sign copies afterwards, is that true? Okay, great. Phyllis is also a donor to the Wittliff Collections. She's generously gifted her manuscripts, her research material, and you know, she stays very busy when she's not doing her award-winning books. She's an actress with many film productions to her credit in New Mexico, which is now a great center of filmmaking, having stolen it away from Texas in recent years. Phyllis, are you going to talk about your newest book? Because I want to mention the title of that. Are you mentioning it?
Just a tiny bit.
Okay, I want to show it. This is another kind of convergence of these fine people that you're getting to meet today. This is Phyllis's newest book. Came out just about a year ago, is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
As far as the eye could reach, accounts of animals along the Santa Fe Trail. Cover art, guess who? Forward by Marc Simmons. Phyllis, it's great to have you here. Welcome.
Thank you, Steve. I am so happy. Good idea. How is that? Can you hear me? All right. I am so happy to join all of you at this special gathering and celebration in honor of Marc Simmons. I thank everyone here who has had a part in bringing Marc's valuable collection, a veritable gold mine, to the Wittliff Collections, and for giving it such an outstanding home and treating all of the materials so very well. I especially want to acknowledge Steve Davis for his great efforts throughout this impressive undertaking. I have brought some items related to my talk. Marc Simmons, Rudy Anaya, N. Scott Momaday, and Fry and Helico Chavez, New Mexico's Renaissance man, we are all from the same decade, the 1930s. Our birthdays are clustered closely in the middle years. Fry and Helico Chavez was well known to the four of us. He was born in 1910 and passed away in 1996. All of these men connected to New Mexico, the Southwest, and the American West have prolific bodies of work. Among the reasons why I spent over 25 years working on comprehensive biobibliographies about them, I believe that Marc's body of work is the largest of any New Mexico or Southwestern author, past or present. Among the insights that I gained from working on the bodies of works of these men are many. But one of them that stood out to me was that all of these men knew early in their lives that they wanted to be historians, writers, or both. Also, and reinforced for me, was that life is a mystery, and that we should do all we can to follow our dreams. Marc knew that he wanted to be a writer and historian since the sixth grade, and he had already begun to read histories, collect books, and gain and gather information. He is a rare combination of skills and expertise. His many abilities shine. He is a consummate writer, an acclaimed historian, and authority on New Mexico history, the Santa Fe Trail, and the Spanish colonial period of New Mexico in the Southwest. He is an exceptional researcher and scholar who knows special collections and archives. Marc used his knowledge of Spanish and archival skills in the 1960s reading and cataloging old Spanish documents for the calendar of the microfilm edition of the Spanish Archives of New Mexico, 1621 to 1821, which was published in 1968. When I say that Marc is a prolific writer with a tremendous body of works, I do not exaggerate. There are 3,000 published works by him, many annotated or briefly noted in the biobibliography Maverick Historian. A number could be added for the years since that book was published in 2005. Remember that those works were all typed on a manual typewriter because he has lived without electricity. Marc has also contributed very much to other authors' works. For example, he has written many introductions and forewords to other authors' works, including one, a foreword for my new book, As Far as the Eye Could Reach. His essays, articles, and reviews have appeared in books, journals, and magazines, from American History Illustrated to the Western Historical Quarterly. Newspapers have printed hundreds of his syndicated history columns. In particular, his very popular Trail Dust column, which began appearing in the Santa Fe Reporter in 1977, nearly 40 years ago, and continued weekly until recent years in the Santa Fe New Mexican, the American West's oldest continuously published newspaper. In addition, he has been a working cowboy, a farrier or horseshoer, once described by a reporter as most likely the only farrier in the Southwest with a PhD, and a blacksmith with his own blacksmith shop. All of his experiences have given him a wealth of information and knowledge for use in his writing, speaking, and teaching. One of my most cherished mottos comes from one of the universities where I taught and is originally from the Canterbury Tales. It is, gladly would he learn and gladly teach. It fits Marc so very well. Marc has long shared his information and knowledge with others, historians, writers, and the general public. Over the years, he has received literally tons of mail, asking for all sorts of assistance and information. He has always tried to be helpful. Historians and many others have acknowledged him and his assistants in their own works. I give you just one example. The late David J. Weber, highly regarded historian who called Texas his adopted home and who acknowledged Marc numerous times in his books. My interest in Marc Simmons and his works began in the 1990s when I became interested in the Santa Fe Trail. It all started with a dream, an amazing Technicolor one, the kind called an epiphanic dream. I believe such a dream should never be disregarded, but considered in a serious way. To make a long story short, I found myself riding in a seat on the front of a wagon, headed across a wide open plain with lots of commotion all about. I was headed southwest, the blazing sun told me so. And the sky was a New Mexico turquoise blue. Ahead, near the right side of the wagon, I saw and wondered a familiar figure. I could not see the face because it was under a dust-covered brimmed hat, but I recognized the stature and the stride. A dear friend recently deceased, a friend who had taken me on many wonderful adventures. It came to me that he must be leading me to another adventure. I leaned out of my seat to try to catch a glimpse of the face under that hat, and I shouted, "I should be walking." Well, the dream faded away and I woke up. I was sure I had been on the Santa Fe Trail. Knowing little about the trail at that time, I still wonder how it came to me. That morning I Googled Santa Fe Trail and found the website of the Santa Fe Trail Association. I asked about membership and was told that there was a chapter, the End of the Trail chapter in Santa Fe. Well, I anxiously awaited the chapter's next meeting, and to my utter surprise, a woman got up and made an announcement that she and a couple of her friends had decided to hike the Cimarron route, the 875-mile route, also called the Cimarron Cutoff, or the dry route, and they would like to have more hikers join them. Well, it wasn't long before I was actually walking the trail. In New Mexico, headed toward mid-Missouri, with a group led by Ines Ross, author who lives in Los Alamos. Her book, Without a Wagon, which of course was our state, Without a Wagon, is here on display. I know this may seem far-fetched to some, but that is truly how it all began, and I am grateful for taking heed of that epiphanic dream. What a marvelous adventure it has truly been. So I wanted to read everything about the Santa Fe Trail, and I kept seeing the name Marc Simmons. The first book by him that I read was Along the Santa Fe Trail, a perfect choice, with an essay by Marc and photographs by an Albuquerque photographer, Joan Myers. It was published in 1986, the same year that Marc became the first president of the Santa Fe Trail Association. In his preface, Marc explains how he became acquainted with the trail. He was asked by the National Geographic Society in 1978 to write a chapter about the trail, and that would be published in a new book by the title Trails West, a wonderful book. At that time, Marc did not know very much about the trail, and so he started reading and got into his car and began driving along the trail, heading west from mid-Missouri, where the trail began in 1821. He stopped along the way to see all of the historic sites and to visit the people who lived along its old ruts and swales. He ended his trip at the Santa Fe Plaza in the southeast corner, where the old gray granite marker marks the end of the trail. He completed the chapter with dispatch and went back to his normal activities. However, he realized that, to his amazement, that he was not done with the trail, and that he would never be. Marc explains in this book's preface. And I quote Mark, "During the short term encompassing my travels, research, and writing, I had become a hopeless Santa Fe Trail addict. The old pioneer road had laid hold of my affections with a vice-like grip, and it seemed beyond my power to loosen it, even if I wanted to. And in the modern trail, I had found something, living and organic, rooted far in the past, and yet still clinging to life in the aftermath of the 20th century. Moreover, I perceived there at the beginning that the trail and all the events that had swirled around it were filled with little lessons, shedding slanted rays of light on the human condition. I began to meet others who had been over the trail and who, to a greater or lesser degree, had also become confirmed trail addicts. They follow the fading wagon tracks in pursuit of an experience that is never quite brought to completion. Out there beyond the Mississippi and across the wide Missouri, in a land of pancake plains, sky-touching mountains, and sage-studded plateaus, the Western Trail to Santa Fe can still capture the imagination and command the devotion of those who, approaching too close, fall prey to its siren call." Closed quote. I have to admit to you that you see before you another Santa Fe Trail addict, just an old trail junkie, but happy for it. I read and collected Mark's books and thought about doing a biobibliography. Before I begin such an endeavor, I always ask my subject for permission, for approval to do such a book. I asked Mark at the end of a chapter meeting. He was surprised and said that no one had ever come to him and approached him with such a question, such a request. Well, I explained to him that I had done this type of genre before and that I had the professional background to do it. I also told him that I would provide him with a mock-up of my vision of the book, including table of contents and some of the various parts that would appear in the book. He was agreeable. Also, I told him that I would have two particular requests. One was, and I ask this of all my subjects, that I be allowed to interview him twice. And the other request that I asked was that I be able to examine his works if I could not find copies anywhere else. He was agreeable. And a trip to his compound, which he called my primitive frontier home, appeared in several happened in several occasions. I gave him my list. He disappeared into his library, quickly brought back a stack of materials. I examined them very carefully, and he took the stack and returned the materials to his library. I tell in Maverick, a historian, about going to his compound and having a library tour. The biobibliography was completed and published in 2005. Ronald Kill's fine art adorns the book's cover, and a double page spread shows some people from Mark's books, Ron's glorious animal illustrations also are in my, as far as you can, as far as the eye can reach. In closing, my heartfelt appreciation goes to you, Mark, for your incredible accomplishments and your assistance to me and to so many others. To Ron for his wonderful art, and to Mark, Ron, Tanya, and to Steve for their friendship. And thanks again to all of you here who had a part, great or small, in having the Marc Simmons collection here in the Wittliff Collections. May the books, documents, papers, and artifacts be used frequently for many years to come. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Phyllis. And you know, this is kind of funny, but actually we have another writer in our archives who has a PhD and was also a farrier. It's hard to make a living as a writer sometimes, you know. So that's Ron Query, also from New Mexico, the novelist there. Yeah, yeah. He said that he didn't last as a farrier long because he got kicked in the head too often. They had the rancher, you know, offer $25 for 3 hours of work. So he went back to school teaching at that point. And you know, you also mentioned David Weber, the great scholar of the Southwest, who founded, directed the Clements Center for the Study of the Southwest at SMU. And he was just a couple of years younger than Mark, but he was one of those people who said, he always considered, he looked up to Mark as a mentor, because whenever you had a hard question, something you weren't sure about, you would just call him up and he would know instantly. He was that kind of guy. He is that kind of guy. So it was nice to hear you mention him. Well, I'm really excited. We now have another speaker. This is our final speaker this afternoon. We are so privileged to have Dr. Félix Almaráz here, a distinguished longtime professor at the University of Texas at San Antonio. Like our other speakers, a dear friend of Marc Simmons. Dr. Almaráz is a past president of the Texas Historical Society, the Texas Catholic Historical Society. His research interests focus primarily on the Spanish borderlands, Texas, colonial Latin America, and Spain. He's won several honors, both for his writing and for his teaching. His books include Night Without Armor, Carlos Eduardo Castañeda, and Tragic Cavalier, Governor Manuel Salcedo of Texas. We're so pleased that you've been able to make the drive up I-35, find your way across this campus, which has changed a lot over the years, and come here to the library. So Dr. Almaráz, welcome.
Thank you very much. And Ms. Phyllis, I appreciate the fact that you reminded me of the Santa Fe Trail, which actually existed. People traveled over it, and it was written about. And not like the trail that just south here of I-35 that was invented by bureaucrats of the National Park Service over in Denver, and they call it Camino Real de los Secos, which never existed. And so now I have a new campaign. I've been in Mexico speaking about this, and I've gotten the endorsement of the National Institute of Anthropology and History, because they worked on the Camino Real de Tierra Adentro. The two agencies collaborated, and they know this one never existed. So if you see, if you go from here, from San Marcos, and you veer over to Bastrop, and you keep on going over to Nacogdoches and Natchitoches, you will see these signs. And they never, there was a trail that never existed. So you see, there's a lot of work for historians, even though they are retired. I am retired, but I never have been certified. So I keep on working. Marc Simmons called me about 6 months ago, and he told me about this event. And he said, I would like to you to be a speaker, but only share anecdotes. Anecdotes of a friendship that has started now nearly 60 years of friendship. So that's what I'm going to do with you this afternoon. So I'm going back to when we first began. It was on a Tuesday after Labor Day 1964, when schools normally began the academic year, when I met Marc Simmons. I learned that he was Marc S. Simmons. And I asked him, what's the S? You know, like Harry S. Truman? I said, what? He said, it's Stephen. So I said, well, I'm impressed, Marc. You have a middle initial. We all should have middle initials. I was in the Army, and if you didn't have one, the Army gave you three of them. So you have to have middle initials. Anyway, that's what Marc told me. He had a little nameplate. I met Marc on that Tuesday after Labor Day at the University of New Mexico as he rushed past me like a cyclone along a narrow entryway at Old North Hall that accommodated the history department on the first level and the political science department upstairs. And as he went by, attired as a cowboy, he protectively gripped two stationary boxes that contained two versions or revisions of his, there's two copies of the revisions of his dissertation to see the Lord Chairman, Dr. Edwin Lewin, without an appointment. That was uncalled, it wasn't permitted, but Marc did it. In what must have been a record meeting spanning less than 4 minutes, Marc executed a hasty retreat out of North Hall, neither smiling nor frowning, as he strode past me to his pickup, the back of which was loaded with heavy boulders to stabilize the vehicle from bouncing on country roads. Among academic students who had earlier started than I, it was known that Marc had selected the topic for his dissertation, Spanish Government in New Mexico. And it was under the tutelage of a very fastidious taskmaster known all over campus by the initials FDR. That was Frank Driver Reeve. For at least 3 years, Marc had researched and written an acceptable manuscript and had officially applied for graduation and paid the requisite fee, only to be counseled by the legendary FDR that he needed to revise and include newly published scholarship. This scenario had occurred twice, the last of which was in the spring semester of 1964, 3 months before my arrival at UNM. On that September morning of 1964, in the chairman's office, Marc figuratively threw down a gauntlet and demanded a change of dissertation director while he carefully placed the two stationary boxes on the desk. The chairman exercised discretionary authority and assigned Dr. Donald C. Cutter to review the manuscript. In a matter of days, all the documents were signed and Marc received the coveted doctoral degree. Earlier on that September morning, the department secretary, Mrs. Olive Knox, extended to me a 10-minute interview with the eminent Dr. Edwin Lewin, whom she said was very busy, but he would see me because I had just been awarded a graduate assistantship. After my swift yet correct interview with the chairman, who was a former CIA agent in Latin America, during which he approved my enrollment in 4 graduate courses and assigned me to assist Dr. Frank C. Stewart, a freshly minted PhD, as a visiting professor in Western Civilization and History of England. Dr. Stewart occupied a tiny cubicle of an office, formerly a janitor's closet, which is why I had to stand in the hall to speak with him as Marc Simmons raced by me to the parking lot. One observation about office etiquette. During 3 years that I studied at UNM and taught 4 quiz sections in Western civilization, I consistently addressed the executive secretary as Miss Olive, whereas other graduate students much younger than I took liberties and called her Olive. For 3 years, she pondered the contrast. And finally, she asked Professor Cutter, who offered a succinct explanation, "Felix is a Southwestern gentleman from Texas." As assistant to Dr. Stewart during the first year at UNM, since I had instructed in public school students at Harlandale Independent School District and accrued 4 years of teaching experience that I could apply to our working relationship. While other graduate students perceived my association with Dr. Stewart as a step down, I viewed it as a hidden blessing because he counseled me on how to navigate the shoals of the doctoral program. In fact, since Frank Stewart had been a classmate of Marc Simmons, whom he admired as a gifted colleague, he advised me to select a mentor who would guide me through the writing process of the dissertation, instead of constructing roadblocks as had sadly occurred to Brother Mark. Admittedly, when I encountered a roadblock of another design at the end of the first year, with the help of other graduate students, I shifted career paths from contemporary Latin America to borderlands history as an advisee of Donald C. Cutter, who had helped Mark during his difficulty. Donald C. Cutter was a strong pillar on the campus. I witnessed him sign a letter of recommendation for a student in modern Latin American history to get a job in Oregon when no one else in the department interviewed on his behalf. Dr. Cutter learned of job opportunities through frequent participation or active participation in professional meetings. All the same, Cutter had one minor flaw. He frequently took leaves of absence to conduct research in Spain, where he owned a spacious apartment in Madrid. And during those absences, Marc Simmons was hired to substitute as a visiting guest lecturer. At the conclusion of my first year at UNM, when grade-wise I had demonstrated that I could advance to the second level, Frank C. Stewart informed me that he would be leaving New Mexico for another position in Miami, Florida. At a farewell party at his home, where I was the only graduate student among the invited guests, Frank took me into his study, pointing to a large executive desk which he could not transport to Miami. He said it was his gift to me as a token of appreciation for having served as his assistant. "I wrote my dissertation on that desk," he said. "Take it home and write your dissertation on it and many other manuscripts." Little did I discern how prophetic Frank Stewart was as a friend and a mentor. The second academic year began as emotionally empty, partly because of Frank's departure and Dr. Cutter's sabbatical in Spain. And at this juncture, Marc Simmons moved onto center stage. In the fall semester, he taught a course in colonial Mexico. Marc possessed a unique gift, taking what seemed like dull, dried historical data and transforming it into vivid, exciting, dramatic instructional material. In front of an audience, he was in command of the lecture notes with expert timing for their delivery. I enrolled in that class, as well as in the successive course in the spring, History of New Mexico. In both classes, I sat in the back to observe Mark's teaching style and to watch the students' reaction. No student ever walked out of class before the silent bell that never tolled. After class, a few students clustered around the lectern to ask questions. As someone who had indulged in theater art, I noticed a slight change in Mark's demeanor. During the formal lecture, he was in control of his performance. After class, when students crowded around the front of the lectern, he became nervous, especially when beautiful young ladies tried to invade his comfort zone. Some ladies were better than beautiful. They were good looking, which made Mark even more uncomfortable. That was when male graduate students discreetly intervened to assist in collecting his teaching materials and walking out with the young ladies in tow onto the campus and the walkway to the history department. And there, the students walked in another direction. In the springtime of the second year, rumors circulated in the hallway of Mesa Vista, which is the building occupied the history department after North Hall was demolished. There was a very prominent professor of modern European military history by the name of Gunther Rothenberg. At registration time, this colorful professor would ask me to lift the restriction on enrollment for his Western civilization classes to upwards of 600 students. Then he would go to a college administrator and proclaim, "Dean, the students love me. They call me all heart. Look at the census figure, 600 students. I request that my history of the Western civilization be moved to an auditorium. And that enrollment justifies assigning to me 6 graduate assistants." The rumor soon began to elevate to facts of a higher order. I had been assigned as one of those 6 assistants. And just before noon, the chairman called me in. And he was very cryptic and secretive, like he was taught in the CIA. And he explained that he had reviewed my transcript from St. Mary's University, discovered that I had taken history of Russia and history of the Near East. So accordingly, he shifted me away from modern European history with Western Civ with Professor Rothenberg. He was going to just appoint me to be a reader grader to another professor named Frankie Clay. So I, feeling very relieved, I asked the chairman if the Professor Rothenberg was going to be advised of the change. He said, he assured me as a gentleman that not only would Professor Rothenberg be advised, but also Professor Clay. And so I went home, and I prepared myself a very fast meal, and the phone rang, and I answered, and I could hear muffled discussion at the other end, then the very incomparable voice, "Felix, this is Professor Rothenberg. Where are you? I am having a meeting with 5 graduate assistants, but you are absent. I know you are a responsible graduate student and you would never be absent without a valid reason." So then I explained to him what had happened in the chairman's office, and I said, I was informed, sir, that you would be advised of the change." And he said, "I was not informed, Felix. Thank you for telling me." And 2 days later, I learned of a lively encounter that had occurred earlier in that afternoon, right after that phone call ended, in the hallway of Mesa Vista. Marc Simmons walked into Mesa Vista looking for someone to join him for lunch in the Student Union building, while he waited for an appointment with the chairman to discuss another visiting lectureship. And seeing that Mark had stopped in front of the history office, which was closed during the noon hour, and then Professor Rothenberg came out, and he grabbed Mark's coat lapels, and pushed him back and forth against the closed door. And, Simmons, what am I to do? I am a general without officers. How can I command 600 troops without a full complement of officers?" And then the secretary heard the knock on the door, the bouncing on the door, and she opened it, and she caught Mark before he fell. And kept him straight. "Professor Rothenberg, why are you choking Dr. Simmons?" And recovering his control, then Dr. Simmons apologized and said, "Sorry, Simmons, please forgive me. I lost my cool when I learned that one of my assistants had been reassigned without my being told as a senior professor." Years later, I asked Mark to reconstruct from memory the rest of that altercation. He said that after Miss Olive had restored order in the hallway, he sprinted out of Mesa Vista to his truck, forgetting lunch completely, including the scheduled appointment with the chairman. He drove out of Albuquerque east on what is now Interstate 40, but in those days it was Route 66, to Tijeras Canyon, then veered north onto Highway 14, to Los Rios, and his little desert retreat, El Ranchito. In the living quarters of the main adobe structure, he feasted on a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and recalled the inexplicable altercation. And before nightfall, Marc resolved to fulfill his contractual obligation to teach the history of New Mexico. And afterwards, he resolved never to return to us for a teaching assignment. The library, yes, but not the classroom. Our friendship continued via long-distance mail. When he read in a random newsletter of my research project on the life and times of Dr. Carlos Eduardo Castañeda, Marc shared some very insightful reflections on the Texas historian. Actually, Marc had been one of Dr. Castañeda's students at the University of Texas at Austin. And just prior to the inauguration of the University of Texas at San Antonio and my induction as the first historian on the faculty, Marc drove down from Cerrillos to stay at my house as my guest before speaking at a convocation of the Southwestern Council of Latin American Studies. One morning, as we prepared to depart for different commitments, he noted an imperfect handcrafted mule shoe hanging on a branch of an oak tree that I had found in the wooded area outside of Breckenridge Park. Marc truly became excited about this makeshift mule shoe with square nail holes. Scrambling to his truck, he retrieved a new, clean, bright horseshoe to trade. The mule shoe, he said, had been fashioned by an experienced blacksmith. And aware that Marc was a licensed farrier, I gave to him the mule shoe as a token of our friendship. And perhaps here at the Wittliff Collections, that artifact might be on display somewhere. Along a third rail of good omen was our mutual friendship with the eminent artist of El Paso, José Cisneros. In the early 50s, while stationed at Fort Bliss, through the Post Library, I became aware of Cisneros' art and of his residence on Hueco Avenue that intersected the public bus line that connected the military post with downtown El Paso. Never did it occur to me to get off the bus at Hueco Avenue, walk over to the residence at 3703, ring the doorbell, and announce, "Hello, I am Corporal Félix Almaraz, Headquarters Company, 1st Guided Missile Brigade, Fort Bliss, Texas." Even on the island of Guam, where America's Day begins, I continued the visual contact with Cisneros' art through the medium of the Southwestern Literature Collection in the Anderson Air Force Library. And you might ask, what was a soldier in the regular army doing at an Air Force base? And that was due to a reform in the Defense Department. They created a special category, Army with Air Force, or SCARWAF. And I became one of the first inductees into that program. I didn't know a thing about engineering, but they said, that's all right. You can work in the office, and you can be in charge of intelligence and secret messages. And how I learned the rules about handling classified information. It was not until October of 1968, at a meeting of the Western Historical Association at the Pioneer Hotel in Tucson, Arizona, that at last I welcomed the golden opportunity to meet the celebrated artist, the pride of El Paso, José Cisneros. Next to the conference registration table, I noticed a large placard that invited attendees to visit José Cisneros' exhibit, Writers of the Borderlands. And I rushed upstairs to greet José and his wife, Vicenta. The dynamics of our initial encounter swiftly eliminated whatever barriers José and I had imagined existed between historians and an artist. Before the end of the day, the Cisneros adopted me as a friend and guide to accompany them to all social events. My self-imposed goal at the WHA was to introduce as many friends and colleagues in the profession to the exquisite, accurate, meticulous detail that characterized the Cisneros style and technique. A sterling pen and ink color, rather design in color, that highlights the Cisneros style is the artist's depiction of the founder of New Mexico on the jacket of Cisneros, the jacket of Marc Simmons, the last conquistador, Juan de Oñate, and the settling of the far southwest, which I saw on display in the reception room. Over the years, my bride Dolores and I have dined in high-toned restaurants, some by choice, others by invitation. In San Francisco, we dined at Sausalito across the bay. In Jerusalem, at the King David Hotel. And in Argentina, during my sojourn as a Fulbright scholar, the deputy chief of mission at the U.S. Embassy invited me to lunch at the fashionable Gato Dumas restaurant, located in the restored Recoleta district, so named because of an adjacent mausoleum cemetery made famous by the burial of Evita Perón's casket. About the restaurant, the chef admired the novels and dramas of Alexander Dumas. Hence, the qualifier Dumas became attached to the noun gato, signifying top cat. Notwithstanding the prominence of the foregoing restaurants, they pale in comparison to the dinners Marc Simmons shared with me. They were home cooked, they were outdoor, they were under the stars. I always alerted Marc ahead of time of my scheduled visits. Yeah, I had picked up a very useful leather bag in Argentina, in which I carried two bottles of award-winning Llano Estacado wines and two wine glasses. Then I would rent a car and stop at a convenience store, purchase a styrofoam chest and a bag of ice to chill the wine before arriving at Mark's country estate south of Santa Fe, beyond the penitentiary on Highway 14, turning at the gate opposite the massive boulders. I always contributed the wine glasses to enhance the dinner and the conversation, also to save Mark's best mason fruit jars for other occasions. At these pignon log grilled steak dinners, topped off with generous servings of canned beans and vegetables and peaches for dessert, we slowly polished the Llano Estacado wine, regaling ourselves with endless anecdotes of stuffy university administrators, especially college deans, not excluding the inefficient deans of libraries. Archivists, curators, directors, and libraries we respect. But deans or libraries are decades away from earning our respect. And come to think of it, I do not have many decades left, except perhaps decades on my rosary. So they should hurry to qualify for their merit badges. Ladies and gentlemen, there was a time when Marc was a student at the University of Texas, and he went on to Spain, and he met some officials in the ministry, the ministry of culture. And Marc was asked to if he would be a courier and bring back to the University of Texas a very elegant, prestigious medal of Isabel the Catholic to give to Professor Carlos E. Castañeda, who could not make the trip because of illness. So Marc told me that story. And so today, in honor of Marc's day here, I am wearing something like, because a half century later, Marc Simmons and I received the same accolade. And so I figured that, I don't know if this is on display somewhere there among the artifacts, Marc's one, but I brought mine so that you could see what it was that Marc carried back that day. So it has been a great honor and a high personal privilege, ladies and gentlemen, to have been invited to remember Marc Simmons, a living treasure and a loyal friend at this memorable event. Thus, I shall not put the organizers of this event on report to the nearest United States attorney for violating the Eighth Amendment, which prohibits cruel and unusual punishment by restricting my reflections of Marc Simmons to 20 minutes. So thank you for all courtesies rendered to my bride and to me and to the Simmons family. And on this very, very auspicious occasion, goodbye, and may God bless you and this institution. Muchas gracias y muy buenas tardes.
That was wonderful. Thanks again to everybody for coming. I invite you to stay and get books signed from some of our artists who are here. And you can look at the exhibit some more if you haven't. You mentioned beautiful young women and Mark, and yes, there are some of those stories in the exhibit too. There are all kinds of stories there. There's also an exhibit on the first floor, the basement floor of the library, if you haven't seen that. So feel free to take your time, circulate around, but don't forget to pick up your pledge card before you go. And thanks again to all of you. It's been a wonderful afternoon. We really appreciate having you here on behalf of the Wittliff Collections. Thank you.